Good morning. So good to be with you. My name is Dub Everitt. I'm from here, Welcome Church in Woking. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I've been married for 20 years to Tanya. Don't know how she puts up with me. I've got three amazing kids, one who's 13, one who's 11, and one who's 6. And they are just loads of fun and really tiring. I am so pleased to be able to talk to you today. And in fact, I'm so pleased to be able to conclude your Loving People Towards Jesus preaching series. Now, I'm the outreach pastor here at Welcome Church, which to anyone who knew me growing up would be a big surprise. And I'm also the author of the book, Loving People Towards Jesus, which to anyone who knows me today would be a big surprise because no one, including me, thought I was ever going to be an author. But I've been amazed actually that God sort of gave me a content of a book to write, and I've been even more amazed to see what a difference it seems to be making in so many Christians' lives as we look at what can be a really scary topic of evangelism and actually portray it in a different way, in a way that I think is more attuned to Jesus's heart, and a way that just really encourages Christians to think, not, I can't do it, evangelism sounds scary, but I can do it. Loving people towards Jesus sounds easy, and I've got faith that it's something that God's got for me. So we're concluding the Loving People Towards Jesus preaching series. Just a quick review of where you've been over these last 5 weeks, and then we're going to look at today's topic. On week one, you looked at that scary E word, evangelism. It's the word that most Christians wish wasn't in the Bible. It's the word that we just want to try and avoid often as Christians, because we've regularly got bad examples of what we've seen evangelism look like or feel like. Either people have tried to do evangelism to us, or we've tried to evangelize other people and it's gone wrong, and it's caused us to think, I just don't want to do it. So it's a scary E word. But on week one, we actually looked at the fact that evangelism isn't a man-made thing or something we've got to sort of drum up the energy and the faithful, but actually it comes from the heart of God. And we looked at Jesus's heart for humanity. Luke chapter 15, we're looking at the three lost parables, particularly the parable of the lost sheep, as well as the lost coin and the lost son, and looking at Jesus's passion to seek and save those which are lost. In fact, that's what Jesus said. Jesus said, I've come to seek and save the lost. And so we're reminded that evangelism isn't our idea, but it's something that comes from Jesus, and it caused him to come to earth to seek and to find lost people in the first place. So that was week one. Week two, we looked at the fact that God wants to do amazing things, yes, even through you and me. He wants to cause someone as unarticulate as me to write a book that's going to help you. And he wants to say to you and me, actually, I want to use you to reach people around you. And so we looked at how God wants to do amazing things through people like you and me. And we're reminded that Jesus said to you and me, hey, you are the light of the world. He said that you and I are going to shine brightly for him as we love other people. And our love for others will actually cause people to be drawn to Jesus himself. We've also looked at the fact that we should love people practically and love people into community before we love people towards Jesus. And we looked at the fact that we're in a post-Christian secular society. And people, there's a phrase, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And so we looked at the fact that we should, in our culture, care before we share. We should love others practically and in all sorts of ways that make a difference for them before we try and love people towards Jesus. That was the first thing, loving people practically. We then looked at loving people into community. And we were reminded that if I'm the light of the world, how and I'm like a solitary star shining in the sky, how brightly would a room full or a group of Christians shine as we connect a not yet Christian towards a community of Christians? And we looked at how in a world of loneliness and isolation, everyone needs community, and there's no community like the church. It's because it's where God dwells and where God shines brightly through his people. And we looked at the word relational momentum. the two words, relational momentum, the phrase that basically means, as we help people connect relationally to other Christians, there will often be a momentum towards Jesus that comes as a result of it. So we looked at loving people practically and loving people into community. And then last week you looked at loving people towards Jesus. And we looked at the intentionality that is needed. We looked at the fact that Jesus himself was super intentional. God, we're told in the Bible, sent Jesus at just the right time. He was strategic and intentional. Jesus didn't wander around aimlessly, but he came with an intent. He came to seek and save the lost. And Paul, the Apostle Paul in the New Testament said, hey, I've become all things to all people so that by all means possible, some might be saved. And God wants us to be intentional as well. He doesn't want us to decide, it's just enough for you to have a lifelong friendship with me and that will do. No, 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 that would be crazy. If you and I know Jesus, then we know how precious he is. We know how life-transforming he is. And we know how central he's got to be for every person that we know, if that is possible. And so our intentionality, our desire is that people would meet Jesus for themselves. And so we looked at the fact that we need to be intentional. People won't just come to believing in Jesus just on their own strength. In fact, in Romans chapter 10, verse 17, we're reminded faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. And so there's a message that needs to be shared. There's a message that needs to be heard so that people can come to faith in Jesus. And so people need to hear about Jesus. And they can do that, I guess, if they're in your life, they can do that in one of two ways. Either they could do that by you sharing Jesus with them. And you might be back to the, hey, I'm not an evangelist. There's also an alternative to being an evangelist. It's to being a witness. The Bible talks a lot about being a witness. And one thing that you might feel confident to do is to share Jesus's impact in your life personally. That's you witnessing what he's done in your life. That's an option. But there's an even easier option, which is I want to invite you to somewhere so that someone else could come and tell you about Jesus. And I think that's something that all of us can do. I might not feel confident to share my faith myself, but I can share and invite. And what's fascinating, and I've seen this so often with people in my life, as you love people practically and love people into community, as you then look to love people towards Jesus, you see that they have become open to the God that you believe in a way that they just weren't originally. And I've got two people in my life whose stories I'm going to share today, who began when I first started talking to them about my faith. One said he was a skeptical agnostic, a bit of a mouthful, meant he was very skeptical, didn't believe, but maybe there's something, but I don't know what there is. And the other one said he was an atheist, and yet both came to faith in Jesus. And it was through the journey of having a relationship and a friendship with me and meeting other Christians that caused them to start to become open to the message of the God that we follow. And so, as you do life with people, as you build that momentum with them, you do come to a point where you've earned the right to invite. And that is the title of today's message. And what you will find is people who weren't open to an invite will start becoming open to an invite as you go on that journey of doing life with them and helping them meet other Christians. What I've found is people aren't just open to invite an invite, they're even appreciative of an invite. They're grateful you've asked them. And now that may sound surprising to you, but I think you'll see that as you go on this journey of loving people towards Jesus. And so once you've earned the right to invite, the thing that's left to do is to invite them. And so the question then is, what do I invite them to? And then how do I invite them? And we'll cover both of those. The first thing, what do I invite people to? I'd say there are probably two really obvious things to invite people to. The first one would be Alpha, and the second one would be to a Sunday morning, because at both Alpha and on a Sunday morning, someone else in your life can tell your friend about Jesus. Now, with Alpha, I think I've become known sort of around my church here in Woking as an alphaholic. I just, I love Alpha. I love the culture of Alpha. I love the friendliness of Alpha. I love the whole environment. And I love the fact that people week by week can come to hear about and warm up towards Jesus. I just love it. And I think the whole culture around a dinner table and eating together is just such an important part of the community that's built, the trust that's built, and then the conversations that flow out of that. I have seen lots of friends of mine become Christians, and Alpha's been really central to nearly all of them. So I'd encourage you, when you're next doing an Alpha course at City Church Bristol, I'd encourage you, be ready to make your invite. That's the first one. The second one would be a Sunday morning. And you might be thinking, well, what Sunday morning? Well, I don't know if you will be doing High Sunday, sort of invite Sundays at City Church. Certainly at Welcome Church, there are two or three really obvious invite Sundays a year. There'll be our carol services, which we're seeing hundreds of people from our church bringing hundreds of friends, which is amazing. Easter Sunday would be a similar sort of thing. And what we like to do on Easter Sunday is everybody will get chocolate who comes in the building. The kids will in the kids' work, the youth will, but every adult as well. We want people to be treated and blessed as they come. So those two would be obvious invite Sundays, but there might be other invite Sundays that come along during the year, and I know that as a church you'll be discussing what they are and when they are so that you can think about your invites. But you know what, if there's not an invite Sunday specifically coming up soon, you can invite people to the next Sunday, because I know that your church leadership team are just so intentional about making church understandable for people who have been Christians for years, and also for people who are walking into your church building for the first time. So maybe the very next Sunday that you feel someone's ready for an invite, invite them along to that Sunday. So how can I make a good invite? So I'm going to give you three top tips for how to make a good invite. And I'm going to share a story within each as well to hopefully bring that point to life. The first thing that I would suggest that you do is, when you're making an invite, be inviting. Because if you make an uninviting invite, I don't even know what that is. That's like a contradiction in terms, isn't it? So any invite surely is going to be inviting. But I tell you what I've noticed that sometimes if you're feeling a bit of a cautious, nervous Christian and you're going to make an invite, I've noticed that sometimes we can make quite uninviting invites to church, which is just crazy, isn't it? It's a bit like, I'm going to invite you to the dentist. It's going to hurt, but it'll do you good. So I'm going to make a bit of a cautious invite, a bit awkward, and I know you're not going to want to come, but maybe, just maybe, you'll say yes. We can make invites to church like that. And I think, no, come on. We're inviting people to something that's good. They're going to meet great people, people whose lives are impacted by Jesus, who are going to bless you and encourage you as you come along. You're going to feel loved as you come because there's people full of love here. You're going to be caught hearing worship, which is just going to inspire you. And you're going to hear a message about Jesus. I want to invite you. Now, exactly what I say to you when I make the invite, I might be quite simple in my invite, but I'm certainly going to make it inviting. So that's top tip number one, make it inviting. Now, a friend of mine, Matt, I met him on the school gate with his wife, Bridget, and their two girls. Their eldest was in the same class as my eldest, and their other child was in the same class as my second eldest. And there was another family at our church, Kirk and Helen, who their two eldest were in the same two classes as well. So I met Matt and Bridget and their girls on the school gate when they first moved to the area, had a conversation with them. They looked nervous. They were sort of stood back from the crowd, and just chatted to them, got to know them. And having had a conversation, we then invited them round for a barbecue with Kirk and Helen. So there's three families, Matt and Bridget and two other families, us and Kirk and Helen and their kids. And we just hung out and we had fun. And then we did the same around Kirk and Helen's. And the third time we got together was around Matt and Bridget's. They invited us to theirs. And I remember standing next to Matt's barbecue and he said to me, "What do you do for a living, Dub?" And I hadn't told him. Often I want to care before I share. Don't want to rush in. "I'm a pastor at a church." So I hadn't said it. And then he asked me. So I said, "I'm a pastor at Welcome Church in Woking." And Matt's response was, "I hate Christianity and I hate people talking about their faith." And that was a really awkward moment. It's like a tumbleweed moment. And in that moment, I just sensed God sort of say to me, zip your mouth, build with him, and I'm going to save him. And I remember thinking in that moment, I can zip my mouth, as in not share my faith. I can build with him, do life with him, be friends with him. But God, good luck with the saving him part, because he's a tough nut to crack. So we continued to hang out. We continued to make all sorts of invites to ours and for walks and for all sorts of other stuff, come around and watch football and to some of our life group socials. That was sort of like a next step of getting to know other people in the church. And they really enjoyed meeting a community of people who were kind and fun and loving, and they just enjoyed doing life with them. And I never invited them to church because God had said zip your mouth. But I didn't know, but my daughter had invited their girls to church. So one Sunday, Matt and Bridget and their girls turned up for church. I remember saying to Matt, I wasn't expecting you to come today, Matt. How come you're here? It's great you're here. How come? He said, Abby's been inviting my girls to church, so I thought we'd better come. I don't want to be here, though. Anyway, they stayed for the service, came to the next week, and the week after, and the week after. And after a few weeks, probably 5 or 6 weeks of coming regularly, Matt said to me, I want to do Alpha. Can you sign me up? And I'm thinking, wow, God, you said zip your mouth, build with him, and I'm going to save him. But by the way, someone had made an invite in the middle. And so they did Alpha. And one thing that Matt said, this was the skeptical atheist, by the way. One thing he said to his Alpha group at one point, I remember overhearing him what he said. He said, there must be something in this Christianity because you lot are so different. What was he experiencing? The relational momentum, the momentum towards Jesus of encountering an amazing group of normal, natural Christians who loved him and were doing life with him. When he became a Christian, he sent a message to our life group. He was on our WhatsApp by then. He put on there, you've all played your part in helping me want to become a Christian. And that all came from us just doing life with him and making invites sort of around the edges of church, and then my daughter making an invite to church. And it was amazing to see Matt go on to get baptized. And then November the 5th, just gone, a couple of months ago, we had a baptism service, and his eldest daughter, Holly, who had been so inspired from seeing her dad go from atheist to coming to faith, she then became a Christian herself and got baptized. And it was amazing. Hey, be inviting with your invites. That's the first thing. The second thing is this, be thoughtful. If you're going to invite someone to anything, you tell them where it is, when it is, how to get there, where to park. If there's a dress code, you tell them. People have got all sorts of questions when it comes to coming to church, all around those topics and more. And so be thoughtful. What are the questions that your friend might have? What are the doubts or the worries they might have? How can you alleviate some of them? So it's definitely a time, a place, a parking. Let them know anything else they need to know. If they've got kids, tell them that there's kids work, all that sort of thing. But beyond that, you can be thoughtful by, rather than saying, here's an invite, maybe see you there, it's, why don't you come with me, if possible? If you can do that, if you can make room for them in the car, I'll pick you up on the way. What about that? What about, by the way, we'll go for lunch afterwards, my treat. How about that? That could be a good one, couldn't it? There's all sorts of things you can do that are really thoughtful that could just help people feel comfortable. My brother-in-law, Clint, and his fiancée, Magda, he was the cynical agnostic when Tanya and I became Christians 20 years ago, and we learned very quickly that sharing our faith is not something you can do easily with Clint. But when Clint and Magda, about 3 or 4 years ago, moved into Woking, which they weren't supposed to do, and suddenly they did, and they moved almost exactly halfway between our house and our church, I'm thinking, wow, remember Acts 17, which you looked at a couple of weeks ago? God has planned where and when people will live, so that they'll reach out and find him, even though he's not far from each one of the one, even though he's not far from each one of us. And I was thinking, God, have you moved Clint and Magda into Woking, right between my house and my church? Suddenly I felt faith to say, God, I think you're at work. And so we were really intentional about doing things like helping them meet other Christians in our church, life group social invites and that sort of thing. And during lockdown, I invited them to do Alpha online with us. Now, they had a young baby at the time, and they would never have been able to come to Alpha in person, but it was lockdown, and so they could do Alpha from the comfort of their sofa. So I invited them to do Alpha online with us, and what I said to them was this. Hey, Alpha's online. You can click your computer screen on the comfort of your sofa, and you can do Alpha with us. All you got to do is power your computer on. And I also said to them, oh, by the way, normally there's food at Alpha. So what I'm going to do for you on week one is I'm going to deliver a takeaway for you. And we can all eat our takeaway at home together whilst we're watching Alpha online and doing Alpha online together. So I dropped food off to him and Clint and Magda and four other people who are friends of ours who did Alpha online with me and Tanya in a group together. So we all sat in our own home, but eating dinner together, and then we did Alpha. Clint was cynical. He had loads of doubts and skepticism, made life hard for us as hosts. After every session, Tanya would go and lie on the sofa saying, why is he even coming on this Alpha? It's like he's trying to belittle our faith. And I'm just saying, it'll be all right, it'll be all right. Anyway, he did Alpha online, still really skeptical by the end of it. But then he started coming to church, off of invite, started coming to church once lockdown had ended. And then a little while later, this would have been last year, Clint said to me, hey, I want to do Alpha again in person. I'd invited him. I want to do it again, but this time with a view to believing. I want to believe. So he'd gone from I want to disprove to I want to believe and did Alpha in person the next time. And it was quite incredible seeing the difference in him. He was asking open questions with a view to understanding rather than disproving. And he finished Alpha, and then I overheard him saying to someone else, not to me, yeah, I've become a Christian. And I had a chat with him, and it was just amazing to hear him talk about his personal faith in Jesus. And one of the things he said was, I know I'm not alone anymore, and I am looking forward to spending every day of the rest of my life with Jesus. And on the 5th of November, alongside Holly, Clint was also baptized as well, which was just amazing. So we should be inviting and we should be thoughtful when we make our invites. Also, we can be creative. And let me tell you about Olive. Olive was a mum from the school gate, and she was lovely, but she was really quite intense. She was really desperate to be loved, desperate to be accepted. And so she'd really push hard to be able to arrange stuff and to just wanted people to love her. And yet the harder she tried, it almost seemed to push people away. And there was one particular time where just a range of her friends just seemed to walk away from her one particular morning. And the only people that were left were me, and Helen, who I mentioned, and Bridget, who I've mentioned. We were the only three that stood with her. And I remember chatting to her, and we just chatted to her, looked after a bit. And I remember us three chatting afterwards saying, let's just look after Olive. It'd be really good just for us to take care of her. And so we started to just sort of wrap her up, bring her around, look after her and her family. And then our church was doing our invite series of events, our fun day, our fireworks night, followed by carol services, and then a Sunday invite. We called it our hop, skip, sing, and jump. And so we invited Olive and her girls to our fun day, and then on to the other events. And at this point, I'm just going to pick up a sheet of paper and read you Olive's words, which will help you see the difference that connecting to our fun day ended up making for her. Olive said this: my eldest daughter was in the same class as Will, Esme, and Zoe. Being a mum without any close friends and family, facing the never-ending challenges of life, I ended up a lonely, angry, and sad person. All my adult life, I've always blamed everything on myself, the friendships that fell apart, the loneliness that I faced, the trust that I didn't have. I had no directions as to what's right and what's not. It was a messy place in my head. Dub and Tanya invited the class to a fun day. I saw the invite in Kimmy's bag but did not want to go. I thought, what if people are standing there with Bibles in their hands, asking me questions I don't know the answers to, judging me, wanting something in return? We went along, and guess what? There was no holding Bibles in the air, no difficult questions, and no judgments. The generosity and the friendliness of people was unbelievable. I then went to the fireworks night, also had a great time, and thought to myself, it's only fair if I go to the opening of the church to show my appreciation. It was one of the best things I've done in my life. Yes, the people are friendly, the coffee is good, they also feed you and look after your kids. Sounds like a good church, doesn't it? But that's not the only thing for me, it's the way it makes me feel. They're my family, better than family. Welcome Church is my safe place. They put a layer of protection around me. I've made friendships that are deeper and lasted longer than any that I've ever had before. I've lived for 42 years and moved to the UK 25 years ago, and I finally belong somewhere. After my marriage broke up, I thought, oh, here we go. I have to start looking elsewhere. I may be judged and not be accepted, but Hanukkah and the Single Mums team proved me wrong. My children love their church. I bring my friends who equally love this church and want to come back. You feel the presence of God and his son Jesus there. It's a magnet that pulls you in. If there was a Google search for what should I do in life, it would be Welcome Church. It is Welcome Church. Now I belong. I now know the meaning of the body of Christ. I just wish I had come sooner. Do you know, Olive's understanding of Christianity before she connected to our church was really limited. She grew up as a Muslim in Iran, and she had all sorts of skepticisms about what she thought Christianity and Christians were like. And then she did life with Christians, got invited to connect to the church, and then made the step to say, yes, I'll come to that Sunday invite. And it has been amazing seeing God take her from feeling broken to being whole, from sort of being wounded to being someone who isn't trying to impress and desperate to be loved, but someone who is just loving others because she's experienced the love of God for herself, which has healed her in every way. And on the 5th of November, same Sunday, Olive was baptized as well. Let me just add one thing to be creative. That particular invite Sunday, so we'd invited Olive and others to a fun day, fireworks night, carol service, and then the Sunday invite. The Sunday invite, we wanted to do much more than just invite people to church and that's it. So as I said a little earlier on, what about a lunch back at yours? So Tanya and I hosted 45 people for lunch after that Sunday service, including Olive and her two girls and lots of other families. And I do think that the creativity of saying, you know what, this isn't just a cold call invite. This is a relational invite. And it's an invite that I just want to remind you, it's because that we're invested in your life and we care for you and we're friends. That's why we did the lunch afterwards as well. It was a busy day for us, particularly Tanya, but it was so worth it as Olive and her girls and Clint and Magda and others came along and were really impacted as they just enjoyed doing lunch and doing life with Christians. So church social events. I know at City Church Bristol, you've got church events in the diary. There's stuff that you're doing, there's stuff you're planning. As that comes up, let me encourage you, make the most of it. Grab hold of those invite opportunities. Don't waste them, make invites, because as you do so, you're helping to create relational momentum that people in your life can be drawn towards Jesus as they come and connect with your church socially. And I am certain that as you love people relationally and as you love people into community and then as you love people towards Jesus, I'm convinced that you will see many Matt and Bridget's and Clint and Magda's and Olive's and others in your life who will go from seemingly a long way away from God to coming to place their faith in Jesus as you love them towards him. Why can I be confident about that? Because I'm seeing it happen with people in my life. But why is it happening? Because Jesus is passionate for people who may seem far from him. Jesus has come to seek and save the lost, including people in your life, and he loves it when we love people towards him. You and I aren't the savior. Isn't that good news? But Jesus is. And he wants to encourage you and me, hey, love people well, love people towards me, and you'll see me do amazing things in their lives. We are drawing this series to a close right now. I've just got some encouragements to you. The first one is this. I believe you've all got a copy of the book, Loving People Towards Jesus. As this series draws to a close, I just want to encourage you, read it through. I think it would do you good as you read many stories of people coming to faith in Jesus, and you'll hear all sorts of handy thoughts and tips, etc., as well. What I love about the whole message of loving people towards Jesus is this. It is warm, it's relational, it's not pushy, it's friendly, it's all wrapped in love, and it ultimately all focuses on one person, which is Jesus. It's trying to help point people to him so they can hear about him, and then they can go on their journey of coming to faith in him. And I can personally tell you that I'd say one of my greatest joys in my life is seeing people in my life come to faith in Jesus, because I know some of what that means, just the life transformation that he offers to them as they come towards him. So let me encourage you, love people practically, love people into community, and love people towards Jesus. Make good, positive, inviting, thoughtful, creative invites that people can come and connect with your church socially and can come to places like Alpha and to Sundays where they can come and hear about Jesus. In Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah encounters the Lord who says, "Who shall I send?" And Isaiah could have said, send that bloke down the road. But Isaiah said to the Lord, "Here I am, send me." Perhaps this is a moment for you and I to say the same thing. As Jesus says, "Hey, I want to reach people all around you. Who should I send?" Can I encourage you to say, "Hey, here am I, send me." In fact, why don't I just encourage you to stand, and I'm going to pray for you as you stand with me. I'm going to pray for you and pray sort of on your behalf to say, "Jesus, I receive this and I want to live a life of loving people towards you." Jesus, thank you so much for your passion for lost people. Thank you that you've reached out for every one of us who knows you and we've encountered you, and we're so grateful. Thank you, Jesus, that your momentum of wanting to reach out to more and more people doesn't wane. You're as equally passionate about reaching people today as you were the day that you saved us. And Jesus, we just want to say we would love people in our lives to encounter you. So we want to take this message of loving people towards you, Jesus, and we want to say, would you fill me with faith that you're going to use me? Would you fill me with your Holy Spirit that I know you're going to empower me and cause me to shine brightly? Would you give me creativity, give me vision? But Jesus, would you give me the faith and the courage to reach out and love people towards you? And as I do so, Lord Jesus, I pray that you would cause dear loved ones in my life, my friends, my family, my colleagues, my neighbours, people I socialise with, Jesus, would you cause many to come to faith in you? Thank you, Jesus. Amen.